welcome to this week's live timeline session. This is the penultimate one of this timeline, unless I get stuck and have to take, or it's not even getting stuck, unless I decide to take multiple sessions per each of the sessions left, but I don't think that's going to happen. So this is probably the second to last one. Next week is probably going to be the last of the mastery timeline, which is really exciting. For those of you who don't know what this is all about, this is where I'm going through the timelines from the Next Generation Clarinet Method. The Next Generation Clarinet Method is my method book slash program. I call it a method book because it's kind of a method book, but I also call it a program because it's so much more than a method book. There's like a 75-page book, and that doesn't even include all the exercises and all the keys. There's another, like, I don't even know how long it is. I think it's like another 60 pages of the exercises and all the keys. But it's a method book itself, a PDF. But along with that, there's these timelines, which is what I'm going through now. And the timelines tell you what to do, what order to do the exercises in, what to be getting out of the exercises. And then also there's links in the book to videos of me explaining how to do the exercises properly, videos of me playing the exercises, and not just playing like a perfect clean run through of it, but actually showing like how I would practice it, so you have sort of something to emulate and something to try to match a little bit in your practice. Not just trying to get the perfect result, but actually the process of it too, which I think is far more valuable than just getting the results. So we're on the second to last of the mastery timelines. I have a playlist on the YouTube channel that you can check out with all the videos if you want to catch up on them. If you already have the book, it's perfect to be sort of doing this along and see again exactly how I go through the program. If you don't have the program, you can get a little idea of what it's like from watching those. So today we have some short note studies, but of course first we have our warm-ups. It's intervals, the changing intervals, the arpeggios. I'm going to do them in A major today, and then short to fast articulation. I had to remember it for myself so I can pull up the right pages. And there's three changing intervals. I've done them all through once, so I'm just going to circle back to the first one. Let me get my timer going, and we'll do some long tones.
Thank you.
was loud. I am going to go ahead and just finish this up, though. There's just a couple measures left. Long tones, taking my time, sounding good, getting everything dialed in, repeating anything that I didn't like, actually playing long notes. If you've watched any of these before, you probably have an idea, especially since we've been doing these for 23 now. It's crazy. Next up, we have arpeggios. These ones do require a metronome. I'm going to go slow to start, and then we'll see. And thinking about what it's actually going to be in A major. Ooh, this is an opportunity to use my left pinky G sharp. How exciting. Okay, let's give it a try. I have water in a key. Let's try again, make it better. Let's try F sharp minor. This one I definitely have to think about as well for sort of where we're gonna end up when we. Getting to C sharp dominant. So I'll just go up. That'll work. Do this half speed. This is a great thing to do if you're like really uncomfortable with the notes. Can't remember the last time I played a C sharp dominant seventh, so this is good practice for me. So I'm just gonna do it half speed. Thank you. Sorry, I'm just sort of experimenting with the notes a little bit. When you transpose to other keys, the pattern shifts around a little bit. And I'm having some thoughts on how might be a nicer way to do that. I'm gonna try it out. So I'm gonna start on the low F sharp, go up to C sharp, and then go up to the high F sharp. So then I get 3 octaves of practice, which is the more octaves the better, right? That's a tricky altissimo fingering to sort out. Let me get it. Oh, and I have to keep the other app pulled up for metronome. I need to not try so hard and it works better. See if I can put it all together now. I just need to check with the tuner real quick where that high F sharp is, because I think something about how that's landing pitch-wise is throwing me off. I don't know if the A is super sharp and the F sharp's a little flat, or maybe vice versa, but let me just check that real quick. So the A is quite sharp, the F sharp's close to in tune. So I was right, at least, the A is sharper than the F sharp. Okay. Sorry, that was not technically part of the session, but if you hear things, then by all means, fix them. And we're on to articulation. Doing the short to fast articulation, which is one of my favorites. It's for, you do these short staccato eighth notes, and then as you speed up the subdivisions, you become more legato and more quick. But the idea is when you're going short, you're tongue's moving quite fast, back to the reed, off the reed, on, off, on, off. And then when you're going fast, the tongue's still moving sort of the same amount, but it's just happening in a little different way, where it's quickly on and off, rather than quickly on, quickly off. Thank you. wrong subdivision. Once through, maybe skipping through a little bit just for the sake of time, the extended version of this, which I do have in the All Keys Companion Guide. It's where you go up, I think I do it 3 octaves in that, if I remember right. So let me try that. And you can see I'm taking my time to like find my good staccato where I'm really aiming at the center of the note and then just really using the tip of the tongue to shape it. That's the time for that one. I just want to point out, and I've done this a lot throughout this timeline, where I'm just making small adaptations on the exercises to sort of fit what I need. The staccato is really good for me. I felt like I was sort of getting some stuff in the staccato that I was actually really liking in terms of aiming at the note and figuring out how to move my tongue while staying aimed at the note, which was super helpful. So I did more staccato, and I did it up into the high notes, where sometimes that can be really challenging to aim at the notes just right. So feel free to always make adaptations and adjust things. Start with what's written and like really make sure that you have what's written down, or even simplify what's written so that you can really get it down. But all of these exercises are just sort of a gateway to get the quality of things going really well. So get creative and do whatever you need to get your very best quality. Now on to the actual session. And I should probably also swab out because I'm already a little spitty. So for today, the focus is page 63 and 64, the short note studies number 10 through 19. And what I wrote for the purpose is, even though the focus is on notes here, make sure that you are maintaining the best sound quality that you can, as well as good rhythms. Also remember that playing the right notes is just the first step. Work to be 100% confident where your fingers are going at all times, and consider how your fingers are moving so that you can play these exercises at any tempo with confidence and ease. So that might be something to explore as we do this too, is the actual tempo that we're playing. But let's go to page 63, numbers 10 through 19, I think is what I said. Yeah, that looks right. Great. And because these are music studies, it's still going to be with the metronome. Let's go like a moderate 80 for now. And we'll probably adjust the tempo as we go. That I'm going many times over it, going for exactly what I want, even on these super simple exercises. Do the simple stuff better and you'll become a better player. But I felt pretty good about that. Let's go on to the next one. Another thing that's super easy to do on these exercises, because they're so short, is practice your audiation. Be able to look at the music, sort of hear how that goes musically, so that you make sure that you sort of know where you're aiming at for the notes, you know where you're aiming at for the rhythm, so that everything can go really well. So now that it went well once, this time I'm going through and really thinking about how my fingers are moving, making sure that they're relaxed, minimal, independent, close to the keys, precise, and snappy. As you're going through these, if you can't think of anything else to make them better finger motion, more confidence with the notes, like if it just feels easy for you, pull out your tuner, see if you can play precisely in tune, because that's part of good sound quality and definitely part of notes, is playing dead center in tune with your notes. Or maybe even play it with a drone and make sure that it all matches good there. It's infinite ways to make this more effective for whatever you need. Anyways, let's go on to the next one. I'm audiating.
Mm-hmm.
let me demonstrate a tempo thing on this one too. So the idea is to be super confident and comfortable no matter the speed. So I'm gonna really bump up the speed. Let's go 172 and see if I still feel comfortable and easy just from that couple times going slow. But I'm trying to keep the same comfort, same precise rhythm, just a lot faster. Now I'm going to go back down to 80 and go on to the next one. This has a lot of accidentals. This is fun. Let me try it again, especially with all the accidentals. I didn't quite have it in my ear the first time, but now I have a better idea of where it's going. This is really good practice for the fingers, making sure I can confidently move through all of this. Oh, this next one's in 6/4. That's fun. I have to make sure the accidentals carry through the measure when the measures are this long. That's always tricky, especially since we're doing some very atonal stuff here. There's a left hand E flat opportunity. That's fun. I could also... could also not, but it's good to practice the left hand E flat for me. By the way, if you're watching, like, feel free to leave any comments. Even if it's the replay and you're not watching live, leave a comment with any questions. I'm happy to answer questions as we're doing this too. Yeah, the harmonies here are definitely very atonal. It's kind of fun. Makes it hard to know if you're played a wrong note or not. But yeah, let me try again. Yeah, fun. I feel like this one would sound good a little bit faster, so I'm going to try it a little faster. Speaking of knowing if you played a wrong note or not, though, you can actually just click the little play button in the book, pull up the video of me demonstrating it, and you'll know if you played a wrong note or not. I'm not going to do that now, but you can do that.
Thank you.
And even though these are note studies and there's not really any dynamics marked, you can still make music out of it, which is always good to be making music, because I think that's what we're here to do, right? Let's keep going. Now we have some altissimo notes. It'll be fun. Man, I am mean. This is actually brilliant. I didn't think about it this way when I was writing it, but it really worked out. Where I'm going diatonic note-wise, and since I'm focusing on the notes, it actually is hitting the clarinet playing intervals harder than the sound quality where I was focusing on playing the clarinet well. So yeah, that was really good. I'm going to pick up the pace a little bit just so I can finish this in time and don't do another week on it, just so you can get through it. But you shouldn't do this. You should spend more sessions on it so that you can get it. But just for your time, so you don't have to watch too many of these videos, I'm going to go a little faster now. Some articulation in there too. Actually think about the notes so I can actually play the right notes, especially on these less familiar ones. This is why these note studies are here, to get the notes. I like it. So close. There we go. And I bet that's very close to the time. Yeah, 9 seconds left. Great. So that was that. This is the notes part. Oh, turn off the metronome. The notes, notes, short music studies, or short note studies is what they're called. It's so interesting, like, playing through these and seeing how it challenges the clarinet in different ways, but also it's just great to have this many altissimo notes. I'm sure it was fabulous for you listening through it, coming through the computer, through the microphone, to have all of those altissimo notes. But yeah, it just really was helpful to sort of play through these things, and even for me, where I'm relatively familiar with it. Seeing it in these different combinations was great. In fact, that's what I'm going to write in my reflection, is to get those altissimo notes comfortable. Addie says hi. Hi, Addie RS. Glad you're here. But that's the end of the live timeline session. And next week is actually the last one, which is crazy that we made it through this. I honestly was sort of reflecting on this, and I think I'll make a full video reflecting on this, but I actually feel like this has been really helpful for even my clarinet playing. I'm going through the intermediate one. Of course, I'm an advanced player, but I was able to get a lot out of this intermediate one. And hopefully by watching me go through this, you've seen how you can get a lot out of this as well. So if you have the Next Generation Clarinet Method, I highly encourage you to jump into it, do it. Remember, having it won't make you better, but actually practicing it and practicing it the right way will. If you don't have the book, go to quickstartclarinet.com/nextgenbook and you can learn more about it. Addie asks about showing the mouth position on the mouthpiece. Yes, look up on YouTube, just search QuickStart Clarinet, how to ruin a perfectly good embouchure, or how to ruin embouchure. And I have a video that goes over some of those things as far as the mouth position and things like that. You can also search QuickStart Clarinet Corners, and I'll have a video about the corners. So thanks so much for being here, and I look forward to seeing you next week on our last mastery timeline session. Have a good week.